You may be seated. Today is Palm Sunday, and still we are haunted by feelings of triumph and tragedy, victory and defeat, honor and dishonor. Today is Palm Sunday, and we want simply to be happy as we proclaim Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Today is Palm Sunday, and there's a crowd of people out there lining the streets of Jerusalem to welcome this Jesus to be King of the Jews. Today is Palm Sunday, and someone who lives outside the city will be the first one to come running down the street declaring, "The King is coming." Today is Palm Sunday, and Jesus the King is coming. The time for ministry is over. The time for miracles of healing is drawing to an end. The time is coming when no one can remain neutral. The King is coming, and we must decide, is he our King? The King is coming, and life no longer will be the same. And so we make our decision as to who this man Jesus is. Is he simply another prophet, or is he truly the Son of the living God who will die and rise from the dead to provide salvation for you and for me? The time has come. Holy Week, the last week, the Passion Week, this week is upon us. Something has to change in our thinking. Something has to be renewed about our commitment as disciples. Something has to be chosen above all things vying for our attention. Within the cheering of the crowd, we feel in our hearts the magnitude of the rest of the story. For we know the sounds of Hosanna will change to the cries of crucifying. Palm Sunday will not let us rest. It confronts us with a choice. And for each year that we celebrate and each year that we rejoice not only at the coming of the King in triumphant parade, but as the servant King who would give up his life for us, the King of all kings, because of love, will go to the cross, be victorious over death, and welcome us all towards victory through eternal life. And so on this Palm Sunday, we consider these four scriptures that we have read as they relate to love. Because we are reminded that love is what stands before us today during Holy Week. So our first reading from Mark chapter 14, we heard the story of the woman anointing Jesus with expensive oil. It's as if this woman and Jesus are the only ones in the room. It's a very intimate love encounter. Love. How do we show love? Well, for this woman, it was in the pouring out of costly perfume. The cost didn't matter to her. The love was what mattered. It was what she had. It was what she could do. In John's Gospel of this account, we read that she also anointed his feet, wiping them with her hair. The odor from the perfume filling the room, filling the house. It was a spiritual moment. This was her passionate spirituality moment with Jesus. It was her moment to convey her love for him. The disciples had been told again and again by Jesus what was coming. But they were not doing anything to prepare him or his body for his death. This woman took all that she had and used it on Jesus' body. We can picture the softness of her hands, the gentleness of her touch, the loving way she moved through this act of servanthood, ignoring the protests of the people around her. Have you ever put baby oil on an infant? It takes a soft touch. Have you ever put suntan lotion on the back of someone you love? There's a certain touch we use when we touch another human being that we love. The disciples were annoyed. Did they really want the perfume sold and the money given to the poor? Or did they just say that to look good? Or could it simply be that they did not see the love with their eyes? Were they blind to the love? Now, our second reading, Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane and he's praying. And how did Jesus show love in the garden? Well, the Garden of Gethsemane refers to a garden that was filled with olive trees, and it's on the slope of a mountain. And Jesus loved this place. He frequented this place when he needed to get away from the crowds to pray, when he needed to be with God. Jesus himself told the disciples, "I'm deeply grieved, even to death." That is to say, Jesus' sorrow was so severe that it threatened to cause his death at that moment. But as earnestly as Jesus is praying, he still cries out to his Father in love, using the most beloved word, Abba. Abba means Father. But to us, the term Abba was an endearing term that you would use for your daddy. So it was Jesus coming to his Father and calling him Daddy. In order to do that, Jesus had to have so much love for his Father that he was able to move from the cry of the human heart that God take away the cross to the cry of a servant's heart that instead seeks the will of God. The will of God to be accomplished even through his death. Our prayers often begin with, "Save me from this," or "Give me that." But loving and trusting God challenges us to the place where we, like Jesus, can come before our Father, Abba, Daddy, and eventually get to the point where we can say, "Not what I want, but what you want." This moves our prayer focus from ourselves to outside of ourselves in total commitment of love to others. Now, in our third reading, we listen once again to the humanity of Peter as in his fear, he denies Jesus. He denies that he even knows who Jesus is. Love. How did Peter show love? Now, I know what you're thinking. You're saying, "Wait a minute, Pastor. Peter denied Jesus. That's not love." But how is it love? Peter would agree with you that his denial was not love. He wept bitterly. He was disappointed in himself, and there was nothing he could do to undo the acts of denial that he had done. He knew it was not his best time, and it's certainly not his best story. Looking back on it, I'm sure it's not the way he wished he had behaved. All of us have stories like that. Imagine how Peter felt when he heard the cock crow and realized that he had denied Jesus. It happened exactly how Jesus said it would. Peter was so confident that he would never deny Jesus that he emphatically told Jesus, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." But there was love. If there was no love, Peter would have denied Christ and just turned away, and he would have been unaffected. If there was no love, why would Peter have wept? Peter loved Jesus and was devoted to Jesus and would ultimately be the rock upon which Jesus would build his church. And after his resurrection, we know that Jesus would give Peter the chance to prove his love by simply asking, "Peter, do you love me?" And speaking of love, our fourth reading from 1 Corinthians, we heard the discourse on love by the Apostle Paul. And by the way, this was not written for a wedding. Now, when we hear this passage, we think of marriage. It's the most popular wedding passage that far exceeds any other scripture. And this very poetic passage calls us to love with a depth and a purity that can only be found in the way Jesus loved, the way Jesus lived his life, the way we were intended to love God and to love one another. Without love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. The sound of a gong or a cymbal is harsh, and it's loud. It's not soft and lovely. A life without love is harsh and loud, brash and sharp, ugly and sinful. A life lived without love hurts others. But this morning, can you hear this scripture in the context of the cross? Can you hear it through Jesus' life and his ministry? Can you hear this God's word through the example of Jesus, whose path took him to that cross to die for us? Was Jesus patient and kind? Yes. Did his love bear all things, endure all things, believe all things, and hope in all things? And did he endure that cross out of love for us? Yes. Yes. And yes. Love is an essential and a necessary thing for the Christian life. It's essential and necessary to develop our relationship with God. Nothing else can compare to love. 1 John 4:16 tells us, God is love, and he that dwells in love dwells in God, and God dwells in him. Love endures. Love prepares us for eternity. Paul tells us prophecies will come to an end. Knowledge will come to an end, but only love will endure forever. We know this. Many of us have seen or heard stories of times where love has triumphed over hate. Stories of redemption where forgiveness has wiped away the injustice that has been done. Yes, we know that love wins. Not once in a while, every time. Jesus gave his all for love. Jesus lived, taught, healed, all for love. Jesus called the people back to God for love, so God could love. Love manifests itself in many ways. A baby stands up in a crib with the arms outstretched for his parent who enters the room, and we see love. A child brings his or her mom or grandma a dandelion from the front yard, and we see love. A preteen opens the door at a store for a stranger, and we are grateful, and we see love. A friend defends the honor as hurtful teasing happens on a college campus, and we see love. An elderly person wipes a tear from another's face as they say goodbye to a spouse or a friend, and we see love. At every stage of life, we see love, if we have eyes to see. Jesus makes his way to the cross, the ultimate act of love. Do you see it as love? He couldn't bear to be separated from you. He died for you. Do you believe it? Do you see the cross as an act of love? Because if you don't see the rest of Jesus' life and the interactions he had with people as being loving, as being filled with love, then it will be very difficult for you to understand that the cross was an act of love. Can you feel it? Do you have God's love? Are you still seeking it? Do you want it? Do you want to be able to say to Jesus, yes, I love you? Where do you find that love? How do you get that love? You get that love by encountering Jesus Christ for yourself. It's found in the place where you meet Christ. Where you meet Jesus, and a good place to start is at the foot of the cross. Will you be faithful and love Jesus to the cross? Will you give of yourself all that you are, all that you have, like the woman with the oil? Or will you deny him and run like Peter? greatest act of love the world has ever seen. And as we work our way to Easter during this most holy week, we focus on God's love. The love of Jesus that was selfless by putting the needs of humanity before his own. The love that was sacrificially given for you and for me as he gave up life and breath. The love that understood our humanity and our need for redemption. The almighty power of God type of love that forgives us and provides salvation to us. These are the ways that Jesus loved us. Selflessly, sacrificially, understandingly, and forgivingly. We are called as his disciples to go forth and love the world in the same way. Thanks be to God. Amen.